Hey everyone, I just wanted to give you a quick update on what's been going on around here. You might be wondering, where is the full documentary covering the Forest Hills shoot that I promised for 2023? Howl Inside the Forest Hills. Well, that's still on its way, but it's been pushed back because the director, Scott Goldberg, is making some major changes, reshooting, re-editing the film from its original version that premiered at Smod Castle back in March. So he asked me not to release my documentary until then, just to avoid any spoilers. And since the new version of the film is expected to come out in 2024, that's giving me a lot more time to finish the doc and add more interesting stuff to it. Originally, the plan was to only make that doc and nothing else, but what happened was I ended up with shooting so much footage, in addition to what Alex Labor shot, since we share footage, that I felt it would be a waste if I didn't also make other videos. So you got the Furlong Files, the Shelley Files, possibly a Shelley Files 2 coming up, we'll see about that, not sure yet. But all of that will have to wait until the new version of the film comes out. Right now, I'm helping Scott put together some Blu-ray extras for it, and editing a new short doc for that, and a longer version for YouTube, so stay tuned for that. The Forest Hills behind the scenes has taken up a lot more time than I ever intended, and progress on my other film, Trip to the Moon, has suffered because of it for the last year or so. Even though I'm happy with what I've done for the Forest Hills, I just need to get back to what I started in 2014.
Nice. Yeah, this is my good side.
That's good.
Yeah.
See?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, if you then you need to take the step there, that's fine.
The movie originally began as a short film, then became a 90-minute film, which then became a 3-hour film, and on paper at least, and then the edit is now like 5 hours long, which I've been cutting it down, rearranging scenes, and trying to get it around 3 hours or less. I do have more scenes to shoot, though, for Trip to the Moon, partly because I like torturing myself, but mostly because I made a few story changes and need to incorporate those changes into the present cut of the film. There have been some other delays as well, mostly lack of money. COVID didn't help. Even though we did shoot during that time, some scenes had to be delayed because of it. I have been working on writing the new scenes, and I'll be shooting that when I'm ready.
Do you remember how we met?
Well, we met on the moon.
We did meet on the moon. That's correct.
So we met on the moon. So we met on the set of film called A Trip to the Moon, directed by Brian Michael Finn. It's still in production, but I think it's almost done. I think maybe, I don't know, maybe there's some more green screen, but it actually did start out as a short film, but he's since expanded it several times. So it is now a feature film, but so I was acting in the film, so I played an angry protester, and Abraham Lincoln's in this movie also.
Should I be as curious as he is? Not that he's real curious, but I mean, should I be tentative to what he's listening to? And...
Well, I mean, they're trying to kill you, so I you would be concerned and curious.
Okay, so I don't think it's Buckley then.
Well,
I mean,
okay,
I know it's
well, the chain of command in that.
Uh huh.
Hacker.
Yeah.
Works with Booth. Xavier is Booth's boss.
And let it go.
All right. Start singing like a music box.
That's how we met. So, and you were a production assistant, and you were, I think, 15 at the time. 15
probably.
Or were you 16?
It was probably like 15 or 16. Yeah.
Yes. I basically just need like 10 seconds if you just like stand there reacting to it.
Well, you got that process as well.
See, the thing is that as I'm moving, I'm going to hear you, and even though you're facing that way, I can see from the side. Just in case I want to capture it, and then back to
Let's shoot. Let's get it done. Let's get it done.
All right.
Let's move on. Let's keep moving. Let's keep moving. Let's not fall asleep. Go, go, go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go. Let's go.
So what's on the agenda for today?
Today we're shooting the second part of the war room scene. I just call it that because I gave it a name. It's not even a war room. It's just a hologram random picture of the cat.
Oh.
Keep him in the back room because he's a pain in the ass. He knocks over stuff.
Hey! Hey! Let me through. I know, baby.
This is extraordinary.
I want to go through.
Should I distract him?
That's bad.
You know, when people...
I could go into more detail, but probably shouldn't.
I'm being pinned. Does this mean we're going steady?
Yeah.
Yes. No loss there.
I have no idea.
Oh, you've always needed a grandpa, haven't you?
Sam! Are you standing by with lines?
Alright, and... Sound is speeding. 22C, take one.
And we're starting from Zahn's line, and action.
I know your ways, and you are a virus on this planet. You destroy all you come in contact with, and you have tried to spread this disease to me. No longer will this be tolerated.
I thought you said he died in the explosion. You brought this menace back with you.
For anyone keeping track, yes, that movie has been in production for 10 years now.
But I'm actually, like, really excited to see it.
I mean, this is going to be, like, epic. You know, I mean, a 10-year project, you know, it's, you know, so much work has been put into that. I'm definitely looking forward to that.
I mean, you know, if Richard Linklater did it with Boyhood.
I mean, we might be right on the brink here of discovering the next Linklater.
I mean, this is true. It's something that's really unique. I think Brian has a real great vision. Yeah, I'm like really excited to see it. I really am.
Years back, Brian actually helped me out when I did my first short film, Fear. He helped us out on some of the editing on that. You know, so I always appreciate Brian. And
Brian actually edited It Gets Better, also my short film.
As some of you know, I did release a trailer back in 2015 for Trip to the Moon and then took it down. Here's what that looked like.
Upon us many great challenges forthcoming in our republic. As your president, I have no doubts that these are extraordinary times, and we face an extraordinary challenge.
Mr. President, it's an honor.
The honor is mine, sir.
Our strengths, as well as our convictions, have imposed upon this nation the role of leader in freedom's cause. Not just freedom from foreign nationals or domestic oppressors whose view of one man is property of their own. Freedom to go where no man has gone and to explore the outer limits of our world.
You ready for this? This ain't gonna be like last time. I don't need you turning yellow on me again. No kidnapping, we shoot to kill, you got me?
Lincoln! Stop right there!
What is the meaning of this?
I cannot let you do this.
I will be leaving on a journey. Its hazards are hostile to us all. And so today, I am announcing that I, along with two of my colleagues, will be exploring the moon.
Close the elevator door and get out of here!
No, I'm not leaving you!
Then you better start using that pea shooter of yours.
Nothing beats real bullets, my friend.
Better stay down or start using it.
Shoot him! Come on! Shoot him! Move it!
How's that for a pea shooter?
Another reason I took it down was because I didn't want that to represent the film necessarily. There were some recasting of certain actors and rewrites of the script after that, plus the effects could have used some updating. And I'm also in the process of using AI to enhance the picture quality, so I'll upload a new version of that when I'm ready.
Oh, that looks so fucking cool.
Coming into the process a little late wasn't that problematic at all for me. I usually get to know people pretty quickly. Especially actors on set, we all tend to be very friendly human beings. It's been wonderful working with everybody and getting to know everybody and your faith and belief in me to put this passion project into my hands is very humbling.
Although I probably end up writing something and, you know, you'll be coming back for additional
scenes.
That's
fine. Yeah,
that's fine. How do you feel about the rewrites and all the rewrites that I did?
I hate you for rewrites, Brian. I hate rewrites.
The night before, you know.
The night before, no. If you give me 24 hours, yes. I like to prep it and bring in something that's, in my opinion, fully realized, and so that we can just tweak stuff. I never like to feel like I'm wasting people's time. So that's when rewrites happen, that's what goes through my head. And I become an anxious little actor.
Back in 2021, we lost our friend Hugh Daly. He was suffering from pains in his foot. And to make a long story short, he was in the hospital for an amputation. While we were shooting in the studio, I got the call on the set that he had passed. I kind of saw it coming, though. My last conversation with him, I just kind of knew that it would be the last time I talked to him. So I tried to stay and talk to him more, but he just wanted me to go. He wasn't really himself in the last few weeks and months, and he just kind of like didn't want to really deal with anything. The first time I met Huey was back in summer of 2001. At the time, I was interning at ABC for Good Morning America and Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. That was coming to an end in September, right before 9/11, actually. This was towards Lincoln Center, though, so I wouldn't have gotten caught up in any of that directly. But I found JHD Productions on the internet and went for a visit and stayed for 20 years. I was still with NBC a few years later. JHD was like a second job. I became lead editor after a few years, and in 2010 I was named vice president. It was stressful but memorable, to say the least. But I got to work with so many people. Donald Trump, like 3 or 4 years before he ran for president, Virginia Madsen, Mark Antony, Lloyd Kaufman, and a lot of others. I can't even recall some of them, but a lot of interesting characters coming through the doors there. We also did a charity shoot with Broadway actors from The Lion King, Billy Elliot, and others. It was actually through Huey that I met Scott Goldberg, the filmmaker behind The Forest Hills. Back in 2003, we shot a no-budget, horror film called Dead End Massacre, where I played this straight teenager making out with a girl. Very weird for me, but I got through it, so to speak.
You got all over me, Jay. That's gross.
Number 5?
Okay, why?
Are you kidding?
My character was supposed to be this jerk boyfriend who teases his girlfriend, gets her all hot and bothered, then turns her down. I don't know why a guy would do that, but that's what Scott wanted.
Can't believe you spit beer on my shirt.
Sorry. Are you sure you don't need any help with that?
Yes, I'm sure.
Then why am I up here?
Because I need your help.
What?
Listen. Why do you like to tease me all the time?
You smell like beer.
Maybe. I'll just have to fix that. Stop teasing me, and I won't have to tease you.
We filmed in Scott's house, and then the bedroom was a set in the JHD studio. That painting on the wall is Joe Zahn's. He's the set designer at JHD. He also did my set for Creation of Dr. Grekos, and his paintings were also used in Nikos the Impaler a lot.
Do you have a gun?
Yeah.
She's asking me if I have a condom, and I pull out something else as a joke, because I guess as a straight guy, I didn't want to have sex with her for some reason. I don't understand this at all. And there's the killer just strolling up to the house with a straitjacket on, as you do. You know, totally casual, nothing to see here. Just walks by everybody, and apparently nobody sees her.
Can't believe you!
What? I was just kidding.
It's a problem. Always just kidding. Sometimes I question whether you love me or not.
Of course I do. Look, let me prove it to you. If you want, meet me in the shower. You can make love there all you want.
But this isn't our house.
So this isn't even our bed.
I'm not falling for it again, asshole.
There was a separate shot of me taking my pants off in the hallway, showing my bare ass, but I guess Scott chose not to use that for some reason. I don't know. Not a very good jib shot here. I don't recall who was operating the camera, but it looks like they weren't sure what was happening in the scene and where it was happening. The knee-jerk reaction to go up, then back down. I don't remember if we did other takes or not, but we should have. I'm credited on IMDb as sound recordist, but I wasn't there for most of the filming, although I did some second unit camera work here and there.
Melissa! Coming in or what?
Looking at this 20 years later, I can see so many issues I have with this for sure. I mean, just how cheap the set looks, how badly it was made, and, you know, the microphone hanging above the painting, and just the bad lighting. It's just interesting seeing it and then advancing as a filmmaker.
It's about time Jay gave it to her.
Being able to actually have a set built so that we can get blood on the carpet. It wasn't that great looking, but we had to use what we had.
And I didn't know you could stab people with an electric guitar, but, you know, what do I know? apparently you can, and she does. So, all right. That's kind of badass, though. This bathroom scene is back at Scott's house, I believe. My death scene being killed with ketchup. I told Scott I didn't mind being naked for the close-up shot with the blood because I've always hated it when someone is supposed to be naked but you can see their shorts or underwear.
What the fuck? Ah!
He said, no, that's fine, we won't see it. And, of course, the camera sees the shorts, as I predicted. I think, as an actor at heart, though, I think it was fun, though, to do. But I think my insight as an actor is better as a director because it allows me to kind of be an actor through the actors I'm directing. I can kind of mold their performance in a way that also fits my vision for the character. So basically using what they came up with and adding what I might do if I was them.
Watching this footage 20 years later, you see so many differences of how you would shoot a scene.
One of the things I find missing from this movie is a darker lighting style. I think that would have reflected the killer better and the mood that Scott was going for. The audio is so bad in the scene. It wasn't me, I swear. I wasn't there that day.
I don't know. I mean, you never know.
Would I lie to you?
Yeah.
What?
No, no.
Good boy.
Actually, you would lie to me. Just like the time you lied to my mom's secret job. It's not funny, Anthony.
Yeah, it is. It's just a funny story Joe just told me.
Whatever.
Bitch. Dick.
I actually never thought I'd see the light of day of any of this footage and everything that was shot because Brian was able to find the footage, and thank you, Brian, for that. You know, shooting on DV camera at the time, seeing all the mistakes and all the cheapness of a no-budget movie.
Speak of deception.
I look at this scene and I see this movie and I just look back and it brings back so many memories and so many unfortunate things, such as just how bad the movie was made.
It's a diary.
I'd like to know why a diary is just sitting in the kitchen cabinet, which apparently came from across the street, but we never see a scene What's that wrong? Shows how the diary got there. But, you know, why ask why?
So the idea was to have some sort of Halloween type of storyline.
What's wrong, Ange?
Let's the door, okay?
I was watching a lot of Sleepaway Camp 2, a lot of, you know, Halloween. And it was just very interesting to, you know, work on the film with new people and meeting Huey and working with Brian as well. This was a no-budget film, and it was fun to do, and I'm appreciative of everyone and all the hard work that everyone had with this particular movie.
Like and subscribe if you'd like to see more videos, film related, and others, and I'll see you soon.